Giannascoli, and I just performed Yellow After the Rain, so I want to talk about it a little bit. It's the first four mallet piece I learned by Mitchell Peters, and he has a handful of excellent educational pieces for four mallets for people that are getting started out. I think I assigned this one just a little before Rain Dance. This is usually the first one, but if several people are playing four mallets for the first time in the studio, then I'll mix it up and give somebody the Zen Wanderer by Peters or something similar. Sea Refractions is another one that's great. But I like Yellow After the Rain the best. Now, this is something I would approach with a student after maybe a couple of weeks in method of movement, where you start to get their hands used to holding four mallets and doing some of the basic techniques. And Yellow After the Rain is an excellent example of those first three sections that we have in method of movement, where we are either doing something like this, or something like this. It doesn't really include any of the stuff that you do starting on page 65 in Method of Movement, where we do the like that. So, right from the get-go, for me, for a singing sound and a clear sound all at the same time, I'm using a rubber mallet. These are the Vic Firth M153 with one piece of moleskin around each one, and then the same mallet with one piece of moleskin and then some yarn wrapped around it, just to give it a warmer tone for the bass. I did a children's concert the other day on video, and I recorded maybe seven pieces. So I went a step harder with these. I used the M154s with a 153 in the bass just because my hands were going all day and they're a little lighter. But I like this sound just a little better for this piece. Now, right from the get-go, we have the chords, right? Quartal harmony. One, two, three, and one, and two, three, and one. And I have just started thinking that I should bring this bass mallet up to maintain that color throughout so it doesn't disappear and then come back once I get to here. And I start here, and then right away move the left hand over for this and continue your diminuendo. I start this at a fortissimo with a lot of arm, and then it's a steady diminuendo where it's going to be underneath the melody. I usually think, and I write this in students' music, the left hand in this section starts pianissimo, the right hand piano, and as the melody comes up each time, the left hand comes up with it, but always underneath of the right hand. And then we do the last one, and I aim for the B flat there, not the D. And then just a little crescendo back up to the A, so the audience hears that A go from the G. And then here, same thing. Now, this is letter B in most editions, and this one, I have the left hand is always over, but it starts mezzo piano, and then the right hand's piano, and the same proportion goes here. When I get to the spots, there's two of them, where there's two voices playing the C, I move the harmony C out of the way. So the melody mallet can continue to shape that melody just like it should. All right, that's my opinion there. This time, I aim for the B flat again. Instead of doing a diminuendo like I did the first time, in the left hand, I continue a crescendo. So it takes us to that four-voiced chord. Be careful. When you have three or fewer voices and then that leads us to a four-voiced chord, really make the crescendo and then lighten up on the four-voiced chord so it doesn't suddenly overpower the audience. You want a nice crescendo to it and an arrival, but not a jump in the dynamic when you get to the four-voiced chord. Now, this is you're gonna have to practice this quite a bit. This one, we're actually doing an interval change here. So the hand opens ever so slightly to get from F to E flat. And my rotation note here is the B flat. So make sure you stay over that. And. Note, it's not just the fingers. Watch the elbow. So I get a good position over the pipe on the F. And then the elbow comes out to a normal, straight-on position for this. You'll have to practice that quite a bit. And this is one of those places where I isolate the left hand. The right hand's easy. It's this one where the interval change is. All right? And that's going to come back in a second with the F sharp, right? Not too loud down here because we want a crescendo up to the top section that's coming up in a second. I'm going to harp on this probably in every video. If you're playing four-voice chords, then your roll should start with the same texture. This sounds weird. Or worse. So start that first chord together, and then right lead to the next chord, which is C, F, G, C, so that there's a sense of legato from this chord. Alright, you want the first chord to blend with the chords that came before it, which were single hits, the first rolled chord, and then the next one to be legato. Lift. That's where I'm leading to. From here, maybe a strong mezzo forte, up to a forte here. Now, the first one again, I strike with the hands together. Then it's right lead throughout. I don't want to lead with the left hand through this section. It sounds like a pickup every time you do a new chord out in the audience. So I do right lead here, all legato, after the first one hits together. And it's pretty strong. Crescendo up again. I just do about four strokes right there and hit off in time so that there's a nice clean. And this F sharp, again, you're going to have to practice this to the E natural. Elbow shift is pretty big here. Elbow out to a straight on position right here. That one's louder, I think, again, than F to E flat, just a little bit. Here I go to the middle of the bar for these F sharp, C sharp, F sharps, and get back. As I come off that note, the elbow's already out. that this still has room to crescendo a little bit. I hope that comes across. I think this camera condenses the sound just a little bit. Now, I did up to there with mallet 4. Now I'm going to switch to mallet 3, and the reason is that I'm staying up here and playing different figures. Now here, I want to crescendo through the scale that's coming up, that B major scale. So I do one in the middle, one on the edge. It's a call and answer for me, and that gives me the opportunity to bring everything down and then come up again. Don't play that A flat in the middle of the bar. It's going to make a crackling sound and you really don't want that. So I play it on the edge, the very edge. Stay away from the string. All right? This is kind of tough. You'll just have to work on this. Keep your sticks down for that soft one. All right, now, set a metronome, whatever tempo you need to, with all this piece, really. But here, and so on. Do that maybe 10 times each instead of 4 if you have to. And then I go back and I do 2 of them. Now, this is a living, breathing piece of music. So once you get everything, get away from the metronome. Don't play this like a robot. I like to play this section a little faster than the previous beginning melody. And to get through this section, what I just played is all you really need to practice over and over and over. The transition from going here to that, if you just work on this, it does it here. Over and over, so you get that comfortable, that transition. I hear a lot of people slip up there. Now, if you don't do anything in this section to control which voice is important, the top voice may be the one that comes out to the listener's ear. Just because it speaks so clearly. I try and lay on the bottom note. Because I want that to come out the most. I like hearing that bass line and the driving downbeat there. The dynamics I do are not what I have in the music, the edition I have, which is the old one that looks handwritten, which I like the best, has personality. I go basically down in dynamic when the pitch is lower and then up, and it all leads me to here. By the time I get here to where we have the C's and G's, I would say I'm going from fortissimo to about a mezzo forte. And then I still have room to take it all the way down. Now there, I can't really play the other way in a concert, because how would I not give a restatement of the theme? So I know what the composer does is this. And I will say, if you live in New Jersey and this is your piece for all state band and orchestra, then you probably better do the way I just did, because that's what's in the music. You could be criticized by one of the judges who is married to the score and can't ever break away from it. So maybe think about that and talk to your teacher about it. Okay, now, so whatever you do there, do it with conviction, right? Now, what do we have? We have this. time here I crescendo again, just like I did at letter B when it was in the left hand, because I want to set this up. I don't want to play softly, you know, and then jump into that. I want to take the listener there, you know? And again, not too strong. A lot of people play this next section so loud, the whole thing with no musical shape. You know, you have to shape it just like this. Give it some music still. You have to make music with this section, even though technically it's probably the most difficult thing in the piece, right? Now, what do we do here? When I introduce this piece to a student, I send them home with some exercises. And this here, of course, that I talked about, but also this. There's a couple things that are helpful, I think, in this section. And it's mainly to do with when you have to do an elbow shift to get up on the black keys from the white keys. So definitely G to F, we go first just back and forth, right? Look at that elbow shift to get to the B flat and keep the F in a good position on the bar. Back and forth, right? Now, I'll do the same thing here from A, right, to B flat. Elbow out over here. And then B flat to C. Elbow out to both hands straight on. Now, next, I want this piece moves along here, so you want a little bit of a bounciness to it. So to get the bounce and bounce to the next pitch, which is kind of hard, I'm going to go back and forth again with a metronome, maybe 10 times this way. And I'm thinking one stroke, three bounces. Right? And I'm not going to just do that. I'm going to go from the F to the G also. Really pay attention to the elbow position, the fingers, everything here. When you practice this piece, you should be thinking of practicing just like you are when you do a Stevens exercise in method of movement, all right? Especially with metronome time, and then when you break away from it, then let that go and just breathe and make music. Right, then here we are. Let's see, A to B flat. And the other. It seems repetitive, but repetition is how you get better. Up. And down. All right, and remember, again, make music. A little crescendo. Down. Oops. More. Now bring it up. And again. That's where I'm aiming for. The B flat to me is the important landing point in the phrase. I hear many times people get to the quarter notes after this. They play it too fast, or vice versa, they might play it too slow. It has no relationship to where the ritardando is going. So please subdivide. Don't count out loud like I did, unless you're just practicing. But subdivide inside that ritardando so that it makes sense and has some semblance of connection all the way through to the very last stroke. And I know some people like to do that. I just kind of and two and three and just diminuendo. To nothing. All right. Now, again, I hit that first chord. Just like that. Don't start with the right or left hand. The first one's together with a gentle touch, though, so it blends with the chords that just came before. All right. Now, let's see. We have these mallets, and the ones I used for the young people's concert, again, the 154s, they're a little harder. Pretty hard, right? They're pretty hard. Let's see. You really have to roll pretty fast with these. It's not my first choice. I like the step softer much better. If you're trying to go with a more mainstream mallet sound, we have the concerto, the khaki ones, and a blue in the bass, which I use quite a bit, you know. If you're going to practice this piece and you're just getting started, after you do your Stevens exercises, and again, use that book no matter what grip you use, you still have to make interval changes and sound good. Right? Take your time. Take everything you just did in method of movement and move it right over to this. Don't go crazy and have mallets bouncing all over the place and be out of control just because it's a piece of music. All right, so that's Mitchell Peters' Yellow After the Rain. After that, I usually give a student Rain Dance and then maybe a Musser Etude and then maybe Frogs. And so it just goes on and on. Try not to skip steps because that's how you'll end up with an injury. So if you have any questions about this piece or anything, just you can contact me on YouTube. You can just write in the area below the video. Thanks for listening. Take care. I just wanted to come back for one thing that I forgot to talk about. And it's, again, the end section where I showed, I think what you should focus on there are the inner two mallets. And one last reinforcement to make this part playable a little more is that I actually focus on the inner two mallets and just play those in practice sessions slowly. With the elbow shifts. All right, maintain the elbow shifts, play just the inner two voices so that you get that focus down, that's what you're looking at. And just maintain your fourth. Now, one other thing, this bouncing, I took it a step further just recently, and I found that helpful, so I want to include it here. Instead of just two notes, I do the three, so we'll do C, B flat, A. And then backwards. And I think that just takes that whole bouncing concept, one stroke, three bounces, a step further, and it helps you again to move through this section easily. Don't chop away at every downstroke because it's going to slow you down and you're not going to phrase as well, and your sound won't be as good either. You want a sweeter sound, not a kind of a choppy sound. All right, and again, thank you for listening. Bye-bye.